Hello and welcome for another installment of our Indo-German Business Talk. My name is Matthias Catón. I will be your host today. The Indo-German Business Talk is the monthly online format presented by the Indo-German Center for Business Excellence. And in these sessions, we talk about different topics that are relevant for Indo-German business, broadly speaking. Today, we will be speaking about the role of women in STEM. And if you're not familiar with the acronym, STEM stands for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. So all those hard subjects where, unfortunately, women are still underrepresented and probably also disadvantaged vis-a-vis their male counterparts. And this will be the topic of today. We have three wonderful guests that I will introduce in a moment. And we will discuss with them what's going on with women in STEM in India and in Germany, what can be done to maybe make the situation better, and all the other issues around this topic that may be relevant. While we have these three panelists here online, we also want to include you in the conversation. And in order to do that, we will use a platform called Slido. And I will talk about this in a moment, but I think we can show you the link already with a QR code. So you can either use the QR code or go to slido.com and type in the number that you can see on the screen, and that will get you to the interface where we will ask some questions in a moment, and you will also have the opportunity to type in questions that you have to our panelists. So I would encourage you to do that. You can start asking questions right now, and we will then post them or put them to our guests online. But before we get there, let me first introduce our three panelists. And I will begin with Anandi Iyer. Welcome, Anandi, to the Indo-German Business Talk. Anandi is the director of the Fraunhofer office in India. Fraunhofer, major German research organization with many, many institutes on all sorts of different topics. And they have a very active office in India that Anandi heads, based out of Bengaluru. Welcome, Anandi. It's great to see you again.
Thank you so much, Matthias. It's an honor to be here with all my panelists and you.
And I'll tell you a little bit more about Anandi. She's someone who is very well versed in both Indian and German business science fields, because she has worked on the Nexus for many, many years. Among other things, she was a special advisor to the Federal Ministry of Education and in Germany. She has worked for different multinational corporations in the field of research and development and innovation. So she is someone who has, as a woman, broken some of the glass ceilings that we may address today. And she is the, or was the driving force behind establishing the quite remarkable and successful presence of Fraunhofer in India. That, I mean, she will be able to tell us a little bit more later, I guess, in the conversation. That is definitely one of the big success stories. And some of the things, or one of the things that I may add, is she has very recently been named one of the 75 most important women in STEM in India. So congratulations again, Anandi, on this great success. And I think it shows that you are an excellent guest for our conversation here today. Next is Srilakshmi Sanikommu. Welcome, Sri. Sri is with Procter & Gamble, obviously big multinational corporation. And she is the head of information technology, Middle East and Sub-Saharan Africa. She's based in Dubai. She is an electronics engineer. So she is one of the women also that we're talking about, a woman in STEM. She has a master in industrial management and over 17 years of IT and digital transformation experience with several leadership positions in India, Singapore, and other places in DevOps, information security, IT innovation, business process transformation. And she has not only lived the life of a woman in STEM, but she's also leading the STEM chapter of P&G's equality and inclusion agenda for the region that she's responsible for. So she's somebody who's actively working on enhancing the situation of women in that field. We're very happy to have you here, Sri. And finally, we have Dr. Katja Lasch. Katja heads DAAD's office or DAAD's office in India. DAAD is the German Academic Exchange Organization, large publicly funded organization from Germany, dealing with all sorts of academic exchange, both when it comes to student exchange, but also obviously in the field of research. She is from Germany. She has many decades of experience and a long career with DAAD, with different responsibilities. She's not just in charge of India, but also Bangladesh, Bhutan, and Sri Lanka, I believe. Run out of Delhi. Before that, she has headed DAAD's International Research Marketing Division in Bonn, where the headquarters are, and the Information Center in Bucharest, Romania. She focuses on international university and research cooperation, not surprisingly, given her job, science-based entrepreneurship and marketing for higher education and research institutions. She also holds a doctorate in history, so she is not from STEM, but she knows a lot about it. So I think that's also good to have that perspective represented here. We're very happy to have you as well on the panel, Katja. Good. Before I open it up to our panelists, we want to involve our audience. And I hope you've been able to open the Slido page. And what we would like you to do now is to give us a free text answer on what you think the main limitations to female participation and retainment in STEM are. So what do you think are the main limitations to female participation and retainment in STEM? You can type in your answer. There's no predefined selection, so you just type in whatever you think. And then what we will show you in a moment is a word cloud where we will see what you came up with. So I'm going to give you a few moments to think and type. I see that people are still typing, which is good. Take your time. What I would do maybe in the meantime, before we get to the results, is that I give all three of our panelists a brief opportunity to maybe say a few more words about the organizations that they're representing. I would ask you to be brief, though, but to give our listeners and our viewers the opportunity to have a bit of a better understanding of where you come from. And maybe we'll kick off with Katja Lasch from DAAD.
Yeah, thanks a lot, and a lot of greetings from India. Maybe in a nutshell, the DAAD is well known for its individual scholarship programs for students, graduates, and postdocs. So we move a lot of people between India and Germany, from India to Germany, but also from Germany to India. To give you a rough number, we supported more than 2,000 people in 2021. Our second pillar is we fund a lot of projects, research projects and projects in cooperation with higher education institutions. 62 of them are currently under funding, where a lot of research is ongoing, a lot of exchange programs are ongoing, which can reach from workshops to semester exchange, but also for research stays. And the third large pillar we are having is marketing. So we inform about research and study in Germany in general, do a lot of communication work. We take care of our alumni, of course. And last but not least, we are active into policy advice, capacity development. And we are also responsible for the German Center for Research Innovation, which is an umbrella organization of 20 institutions. Out of them, 14 active in research, which are based out of India. So we have universities, German universities under the umbrella. Fraunhofer Gesellschaft Anandi, that's where we know each other from, is there. And where we foster research cooperation, a lot of communication activities, and offering platforms to connect researchers. I think that it would be in a nutshell about the large organization, DAAD, and I think further we can take it up in the discussion.
Great. Thank you, Katja. And that is probably a good segue to Anandi, because Anandi is representing also a German organization, but with a slightly different focus, and that is Fraunhofer.
Yeah, thank you so much. So Fraunhofer is one of the world's largest applied research organizations, particularly Germany's, Europe's number one. And what we really do is take research from the lab to the market in the shortest period of time. So we are inventors, researchers, and entrepreneurs rolled into one. Some of our famous inventions are the MPG software, the white LED, and many such inventions. We have 76 institutes in Germany, across industry subsectors, which we are pretty agnostic about. We are more concerned about the application and the multidisciplinary application of science into the world. And we have about 30,000 researchers with advanced degrees in science and engineering. And we also have an annual volume of over 3 billion euros in research. So a pretty large organization, but we do not stand alone. Like Katja said, we work in an ecosystem. The scientific landscape in Germany is a very united ecosystem, where you have universities on one side, organizations like the DAAD, DFG, and even Max Planck, and many such organizations that do amazing amount of work in research and education. And all that work that happens in these institutions also flows seamlessly into one another. We are a global organization. We may be headquartered in Germany, but we have a global footprint with presence in more than 82 countries. India is one of the leading countries where we have several projects, and we are earning more than 5 to 7 million euros a year. So it's a very established institution of over 70 years. The other bit I would like to quickly talk about is my role with Women in STEM. I am the chairperson for the WISE, which is the Women in Science and Entrepreneurship. So the subject is extremely close to my heart. And I'm also the lead for the G20 STEM part, Women in STEM. So I think in a nutshell, research and women, those are two aspects that really drive me and keep me awake at night. Thank you.
Great to hear that, Anandi. And obviously, that is the reason why we invited you to participate in this webinar. Let me move on to Srilakshmi Sanikommu. She is with Procter & Gamble, and I guess Procter & Gamble is really one of these organizations that need no introduction. We all know the company, I suppose, and we are all probably also using some of their products on a regular basis, I suppose. But maybe you could give us a little bit more information about the STEM chapter and what you're doing there in particular.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. I really appreciate what you said, which is P&G needs no introduction. That's the kind of trust that we enjoy with our consumers as they use our products on a daily basis in millions of living rooms, kitchens, laundry rooms, and bathrooms. And it's a legacy of 180 plus years that we have, and we highly value it. When it comes to equality and inclusion, we have a very, very strong agenda covering all of our employees, our partners, through our brands in a very consistent way. And we've been doing active work in equality and inclusion with multiple lenses, including gender, disability, and STEM is one of the most recent chapters we've added, at least in the Asia, Middle East, Africa region. STEM for us globally has been a chapter for quite some time now, but in AMA we've realized that we need to take this cause and champion, add the power of the brands and the power of the people that P&G has to make an external impact as well as an impact internally. You know why STEM matters to us. You may think we are an FMCG company, and what's technology, research, and engineering is to do with building, making shampoos and detergent powders. There's more to it than meets the eye, right? Starting with how we manufacture our products, the technology that goes into it, how we make sure the right product is available in the stores for consumers to buy. There's a lot of data science we use today to make sure that happens. There's a lot of consumer behaviors are changing, right? You know, consumers are now very digitally savvy. They want us to reach and communicate where they are available, which is primarily mobile and social. There's a lot of digital technology that we use and embed into our operations, into the way we make decisions, and the way even we manufacture our products. Oral-B IO that we have released is a great example of embedding technology into our product itself. What used to be a traditional, probably plastic or wooden brush, it has now technology that can help your mouth become cleaner. And I give that context to emphasize how important STEM talent and STEM skills are for P&G's business growth. And it's imperative that they invest both internally and externally to drive the change.
Good. Thank you very much to all three of you for this brief introductions to your organizations and a little bit also what they do in the STEM field. Now let's get to the first question and let's see what answers the viewers came up with. So I hope you can all see this now on the stream. We have a pretty broad field of issues that have been mentioned. So I guess that's probably enough for at least three more follow-up conversations like this one. We start with the economic opportunities, obviously, certain societal things I see here, the gender bias in society, also family influences, sexism in the workplace, and then, of course, few role models, which is a little bit the chicken and the egg problem here, I guess. Education is mentioned. That is certainly something that I believe we should address today. Gender neutral tech. That is an interesting point. You know, is tech, is it neutral or maybe not? Yeah, and maybe is that also a barrier? Awareness, systemic barriers. There's quite a few things that our audience mentioned, and I think they will be good points where we can develop or start our conversation on. Before we do that, before I hand it over to our panelists to react to some of these things, we would like to post a second follow-up question. And that question is a ranking. So we would like to know from our viewers, where do you think do we have to make the changes? So which of these different places or levels of society are key for making the changes? So please go to Slido and input your own ranking order now, and then we'll see a little bit what priorities our viewers would give to the different items. Okay, is this the current order that we're seeing? Good. So, okay, so we have a relatively clear order. Interesting. Oh, it's still moving. We just had a switch. Okay, so this is interesting. I believe that our viewers think that education is the most important field to make changes, followed by government policymaking and the workplace. Well, we had another switch. Maybe it's still work in progress, but education, primary, secondary education, and government policymaking are still at the top. Interestingly enough, and maybe I'll ask our panelists to react to that, at home and individual factors plays last. So it seems to be, at least when it comes to our viewers, something that is more systematic or to be addressed on the level of society as a whole. Let's start maybe with Sri, and I mentioned that you know she is a very successful woman in STEM. If you look back when you were younger and you started out your career in STEM, was it difficult? Was it a difficult decision for you to make? Did you face any obstacles? Maybe shed some light on your personal career, if you will.
Yeah, sure. Like I said, I'm an electronics engineer, and an industrial management. Now, when I was in engineering, there were about 30% of the class was women. As I moved to industrial management, it became 15%. In my own personal experience, the higher you go in terms of pursuing STEM education, the percentage of women enrolling for the drops, right? There's another interesting statistic I'm sure most of you know is in India, actually, STEM graduation is not a problem. There is more than 40% of STEM graduates are women. This is highest globally, right? However, only 14% of them end up being researchers, scientists, and enroll into core STEM professionals. So I tend to believe that the problem, actually because of very positive government interventions, the enrollment into STEM education has been pretty good. Now, where we need to bridge the gap is beyond the, just the graduate STEM graduation, how can we further continue to improve the skills of women to pursue research and stay longer in STEM careers? And second, take up STEM professional jobs. So you asked me when I took over, when I decided to pursue a career in IT, for me, it was actually not a big decision. I thought IT was a really good career for me and I went in. From among the factors that were discussed at home, our upbringing was very gender neutral. You know, we are two sisters. My father never let us feel like we are any different from any other child, right? So we went on to pursue, my sister is a doctor, we went on to pursue what we are passionate about, and we did it. So I do think upbringing does make a difference, but as, you know, women grow, they make their own choices. And I believe the choice of taking up a STEM career is slightly beyond the home environment. Of course, marriage and life stage has a bigger influence once the life stage changes, right? So I do believe that, you know, encouraging more and more women to take up STEM careers beyond the STEM graduation is the opportunity that we have today. And we as PNG are playing quite an active role through our brands. For example, Olay is offering scholarships to girls in STEM so that they can continue to pursue STEM education in India. Similarly, in Vietnam and other countries, we are offering scholarships as well. What we've recently done, we realized the fact that women are dropping off from careers because of several reasons, you know, life stage, priorities, being able to cope up and all. So we've launched this program called Relaunch, in which we really welcome women who have taken a career break for whatever reason to apply to PNG positions, and we help them get back into the organization and be successful through very, very specific programs oriented for them. So to summarize, I believe a combination factors need to be in place for us to be able to influence this change, right? So number one is home environment has to be conducive and encouraging. Second, women need to opt for STEM careers as a choice they are making. Third, workplaces need to create a supportive environment around these women to continue to pursue their careers and stay longer in this.
Anandi, let's move over to you as another woman who has made a career in STEM, but as far as I understand, has also mentored a lot of women and is actively working. When you hear Sri say that, say, well, the issue is not about education, but it's about this transition into the workforce and obviously then also staying in that career and moving up the ladder. What's your take? Is that really the issue? And if it is, what could we do? What can be done to change that?
Oh, I cannot agree more with what Sri just said. You know, I think it's absolutely on the dot. The fact is that, like she said, first of all, for every 1,000 men in India, there are 1,200 women. So we are really talking about a majority. But the majoritarian view is very male. The majoritarian business environment is very male. And so traditionally, all the systems, the ecosystem, the tools are all developed by men for men. So there needs to be a very conscious and systemic change to include women, and not only women, but all the other categories of people who have not received that kind of attention. So we need to become a more inclusive workplace. Now, in the case of women, like Sri said, it's not a very smooth and singular path. What happens is women, girls come into STEM, like she said, 40% of Indian girls, of the students in India are women. But by the time they get into additional qualification courses, there is a 51% drop. Then there is another 50% drop at the level of managerial candidates, because they get into family life and they have other issues. We did a survey recently and we found that in-laws particularly prefer that women take on very traditional roles because they should come home early, they should look up. So the caregiver role becomes more important than the professional role. And women tend to give in to that, right? Now, if we assume that the woman is a primary caregiver and wants that choice, because a choice is important, we do not want to impose something, we have to create an environment where there are tools that a woman can stay productive, because it is very clear that there is a business case for women to be in active professional life. And that's where the digitalization and digital tools come into play. Programs like Relaunch are great. But we are seeing that in some of these cases, women have fallen out 6 years and they don't even know how an inbox works today. So before they come in, and there's technology is changing at a very rapid pace. So I think we need to keep women active even when they are not in active professional life by offering them tools to stay abreast of technology, stay abreast of qualifications. And finally, we need to get women in decision-making roles, like a board position, because unless you give a voice to that category of people, the boardroom is full of men. I sit on couple of board positions and I see the environment. It's not conscious, it's very subconscious. But why would a man think of getting a woman into a position when it is a very cozy club, right? So we need to break that monotony and say, look, there is another view. Maybe a contrarian view, but it needs to get an expression. So I think getting girls into STEM, keeping women in professional positions, and getting them into positions where they can make decisions and make their voices heard is extremely important to kind of balance this picture.
Thank you very much, Anandi. And I want to bring in a little bit the German perspective, because at the Indo-German Business Talk, we obviously look always at both countries and we try to compare them, try to see what we can learn from each other. So I want to move on to Katja Lasch. We've heard from both Anandi and Sri that enrollment rates in STEM subjects at Indian universities are actually quite high for women, so about 40%. How is the situation in Germany? How can we compare that?
Yeah, I would think at an overall level, we have the same difficulties. There's one difference, that the enrollment rate is a bit lower in STEM, and there's a lot of initiative at the moment to get more girls into the higher education institutions and to start already in kindergarten. Role models was on the first slide to encourage them to take up fields. And I think one has also make a difference in between STEM. So we see, for instance, in mechanical engineering, there's barely a woman enrollment. So one needs to look specific in the field. So to say STEM enrollment is a bit difficult, because in ICT, computer technologies, you see more of them. Mechanical engineering, electrical engineering is really, really male dominated. So I think we need to focus, and focus especially on these fields where we have problems. When we look to further careers, stepping into the professional field, I think it's a general matter of women stepping into profession, lesser than specific into STEM, I have to say. I would not see such much of a difference here. Surprisingly, we stepping back in Germany. So we have a lot of discussion at the moment. We have a lot of good academicians. We have lack of workforce in Germany, and we have a lot of women who go for traditional way now. This is a new trend. Or 5-10 years ago, women were independent. They went for work life, and we see a bit of a trend. And I think what is needed here is more flexible work models. And there it can get tricky in the STEM field. So we need agile working. Digitalization was named by Anandi. So to have more flexibility for part-time jobs, for instance, to keep the well-educated woman in the STEM field in the loop, in the industries, to not waste that human potential, which we have. And I think if we look further, be it in academic or be it in industry careers, we need a change of mindset. We need more women on board, so they would then get other women on board too in the boards. But I think we need also more mentors, and we need more encouragement for women. So it's about soft skills. So there's a lot of discussion ongoing at the moment. So to encourage more, to be more self-confident on the skills one has, and to also take as a woman here and there the the habitats and of the men, so to persist in that environment. So there needs to be specific skill training, specific mentoring and encouragement, so that women also by themselves step more into the leading positions and don't tend to stay in middle management because it's comfortable, and so that they have the skills to persist in this male dominated upper management management world. But in general, I would say same problems here and there, a bit different, small differences, but I think it's a worldwide trend. But I would see it a bit on a more general level. And if we talk about STEM, I think we need to look into the different subject fields.
Couple of interesting points here. Thank you very much. I think we need to keep track of all those interesting discussion points. Flexibility was a major issue that was mentioned both by you, Katja, and by Anandi earlier. I find it discouraging. I didn't know that you actually see data that the women participation in some of these areas is actually going back in Germany rather than advancing. Before I continue with the conversation, I would like to encourage our audience to post questions using Slido. You can see the link again. If you have any either questions, could also be a comment, please post it there, and I will then bring you into or your question into the discussion and address it to our panelists. Flexibility was one of the things mentioned that might make it easier for women to square the either expectations that are being raised or also their personal preferences. Sri, how is it at P&G? Are there possibilities also in STEM fields to, for example, work part-time, work from home? How does it work at your company?
Oh, I know. I think COVID has shattered a lot of myths, and I think it's in favor of women, to be very frank, right? The general tendencies towards looking at work from home as necessarily a productivity drainer is questioned everywhere, right? So I think the trend of working from home is a lot more adopted than ever before, and that's the good news. Now, in terms of flexibility, I really think women need different types of flexibility at different types of and at different points in their life stage, right? For example, when the most important one is maternity, right? Soon after you have your child, that phase can be a really difficult one for the mother in terms of balancing bringing up the baby and also taking care of work responsibilities. This is where in P&G, what we've done is we've co-located childcare facilities along with our offices. So women can come to offices bringing their children, and they know that they are in a safe environment and they can reach out to their children as soon as possible while even they are at work. So that's one major intervention we've done in most of our critical places. Now, apart from flexibility, I also want to talk about what Katja mentioned, which is different streams of STEM have different challenges. Now, mechanical engineering for sure is a lot different versus computer science engineering, and P&G heavily relies on manufacturing and expertise in engineering, right? So what we are doing in some of our markets, especially in Egypt and India, is to bring women onto the shop floor, onto the manufacturing floor, and show them it's really not that difficult or unimaginable for women to be working with machines and robots. And it's as easy as a man would do it, right? What though we need to encourage is today the shop floors are a lot more dominated by male than women. So by bringing them over and showing them the women employees at P&G manufacturing facilities, we also inspire them and show them that it can be done. A lot of times we get very positive feedback that, you know, having this experience of visiting the facility really helps us think about a lot more career opportunities versus, you know, thinking about them narrowly.
Interesting. So flexibility, also the opportunity or the infrastructure in place, for example, when it comes to childcare. And then again, the topic of the role model, which is a bit of a seems to be a bit of a catch-22 situation. So if there are not that many women in one particular work or field, so that might scare away or discourage women, which then, you know, leads to the unfortunate situation that it doesn't change. So That's probably also a conundrum that is quite common. Because I want to bring in personal experiences as well. And I asked Sri the question earlier, Anandi, how was, if you look back at your career so far, how was your experience? How did you handle all these issues and these difficulties? Was it easy? Where did you maybe doubt also at some points? Could you share some lights, maybe also, you know, acting as a role model for some of the female listeners who may be at an earlier stage in their career and maybe interested in hearing about someone who made it in that field?
Yeah, I mean, it never was easy and it still isn't. Yeah, so I think as a woman in a room full of men, you constantly have to prove yourself, even if you may not be thinking about it, but the situation really demands. So you are in a way in the spotlight. In my early years, when I think I was not even 30, when I was deputy head of a very large organization, which was again in research and innovation, etc. So male dominated and even senior men dominated. So it was quite intimidating in very many ways. And initially they would see me either as the young girl who would bring in the coffee or a glamorous, good looking woman. And so the comments would usually be around those lines. And my way of dealing with it after feeling terribly hurt and, you know, but why? I mean, I'm equally qualified and why should I be seen in this role? I began to think that why should I even react to that, right? I mean, I'm here because of a capability. I'm here because I've achieved a certain responsibility. And so I stopped thinking about them and I started thinking about what I wanted to do in my role. And that really helped. So late in my later years, it also became a subconscious defense mechanism that I would just block out the number of men because I would very usually have in a room of 200 people, just three women or even sometimes single. So if I started to worry about those, it would become very difficult for me. So I started to shut it out. And many years later, when people would ask me, how do you deal with being in a room full of men? My response always was, I don't see it. I'm here to do a job and I'm just doing what I'm good at. So I'm sure the men there are not thinking about this one woman in the room. So I also don't have to think. And talking about role models here is extremely important. I think more than role models, it's about sharing experiences because women shouldn't think that they're alone in this journey or what's happening to them is happening only to them. It's happening to all the women. So I'd like to take 1 minute to tell you about this scholarship things that companies are doing. I would like to suggest that we should look at fellowships for women when we give these kind of scholarships. It's not just money for them to do a particular course, but actually handhold them for 3 or 4 months through with soft skills, with mentoring, because that becomes holistic. And this is what we have launched in my council, where Hindustan Lever has come in with a fellowship for women from 2 and 3 tier cities to do advanced degrees in science and engineering, but with 2 to 3 months of mentoring by HUL senior management, which supports them with communication skills, negotiation skills, you know, being confident, and so many other things that such girls need. And sorry for being a little long in my answer.
That's absolutely okay. Thank you very much for sharing also your personal experience, which I think is absolutely fascinating and also very relevant. So now let's turn it to the audience because there are questions. And the first question, I'm going to read it, but I hope you can also see it on the screen, is my question is regarding family role as a mother and wife. Does your role as a successful woman reflect somehow on your role as a mother? Now, I don't know of the three panelists who is a mother actually and who is a wife. So I'll just throw it out in the open. Whoever feels comfortable or willing to answer that question, please go ahead.
I'm not in a position to answer here.
So. Fair enough. Fair enough. Any of the others?
Well, I'm a mother of two.
Okay.
And a son and a daughter. And I must say that my children are extremely proud of what I do and they're very supportive. And on the other hand, I think they've also learned to become extremely independent and very confident children because they see their mother handling 100 things and they kind of step in to help. So for But of course, it takes a whole family to support a working woman. And I think that's extremely important. So the role of a woman is not just a mother, wife, etc., but it's a member of the family. And the other members are equally important, and they need to put up their hands and jump in to do things together. And that's what makes a woman successful, I think. The confidence that at home she is valued, her struggles are recognized, and they are participants in, you know, her success. I think that matters a lot.
Good. I absolutely agree with Anandi. I have two children as well. And I often reflect on how helpful my husband is, and how much without his support, I wouldn't have been where I am, to be very honest, right? So a strong family support is an extremely important foundation to women being successful. And another view of this is, being a mother, I actually feel I'm better at work because I focus. I don't have infinite time that I can expand in the office. I have priorities at home that makes me a lot more efficient, and also a bit of an empathy towards the life goals and challenges that my team members might be going through, having passed this life stage myself. So I think being a mother and a working professional, if you have the strong support system, is an extraordinary thing.
Good. Yeah, great. I think this is probably also encouraging for some of our viewers, hopefully, to hear from these two panelists who have been able to have both a successful career and also children. And I found it interesting what you said at the entry, is that maybe that can also qualify you better, this experience, than other men. I think that's a quite a good perspective, because we shouldn't always address it from, you know, as if women had to somehow catch up with men, but they can also bring certain other qualifications to the table that lack men, and men lack the other way around. And that is a good segue actually to another question that we have from our audience, which I find interesting. You talked about the necessity of women to change to a male-dominated environment, but to turn it around, what do you think can be done on the male end? So I'm going to be curious to hear what that might be.
I can maybe take that up. I think that came a bit from my comments. So I think also male need to change, but I think, as I said, it's a question of education in a way a bit. So to have role models. What I meant by adapting to the male is, and I think that's what Anandi said, so one has to present the work which one does, no? And not to say, and nobody will see you if you stand in a corner and just are really eager on working your things, but you have to be a bit more confident and gain this confidence. I think that is what I meant by adapting to the male environment, where confidence and plays a major role. So nobody will see you. You can do a good work, but if you don't showcase your good work, that will not be recognized. And I think important here is really to have mentors in that field who who are on your side. Maybe a bit of my personal experience, you see in academia, exactly the same thing like in STEM, no? The higher you climb the ladder, the more male dominated it gets. And I had the luck when I entered my position that I had a woman mentor, and who led me through these things, who explained me a lot of things, how like these meetings are functioning, what one has to do. So to pay attention to myself, to adjust. And then I think what we can bring as women is a different leadership, a different kind of leadership, and that will then probably also change the male environment. So I think it's also on us to influence that, and by working together, bringing in different perspectives, different approaches. That's why one also likes to work in industry and interdisciplinary teams, no? For instance, so to change the male environment through us, through our inputs, and through working with us.
Good. Anything you'd like to add, Anandi or Sri? What should men do? What can we do also to support women in STEM in particular?
I recently came across an example of a young girl from a lower middle class who was extremely well supported to get into the university. And I work with an NGO, and she came to us completely crying and shattered, saying that, look, I don't want to go to the university, after having topped her course and done everything. And when we asked her why, she said she was extremely bullied by her male co-colleagues and students. I think young men need to be much more responsible because, you know, this is a world that is changing. And if young men do not step up and support their colleagues, I think that's really sad. So I would really send out a message to the young men out there to be more supportive of women, whether it's in college or in, you know, or in the workplace, and to be a little bit more aware, because it is quite easy for them to slip into their comfort zone and, like Katja said, not see the woman or even be a little aggressive to women who may be trying to reach out. So I think a little bit of empathy and sensitivity on the part of men, and we need men in this struggle. We need to co-opt men who support women. So in the Vice Council, we are planning to set up an award for male cheerleaders who support women in their growth. This is not about a it's not a polarized world, men versus women. I think we need to be stakeholders. And while the empowerment for women has to be led by women because it is our case, I think we need stakeholders like men and other people to join us and be a part of a world which is more equitable. We are not looking for equality. We're looking for an equitable world where merit is on top, but everybody has a chance at that small piece of cake, and that it's a fair world out there, however utopian it may sound. But I think at least the goal should be a little higher than what it is right now.
Thank you. I think that was a passionate plea that we can probably all accept and support. Anandi, I'll ask another question to you, because I know that you're involved in many initiatives that try to address women participation in the workforce. We have another question from the audience that says, why do a lot of initiatives address the gender gap but not the pay gap? In your experience, is that true? Is that a valid question? And if so, why might that be the case?
I think it is true. Otherwise, it would not be addressed in this format. But we don't know the reasons why. But I think, again, here, women are not great negotiators. You know, I have hardly heard of a woman who goes to a pay council and say, I need more pay or I need a better, condition. So we ourselves are also to blame that we have not raised our voice against the system. And we have sent some recommendations to the government recently where we've said, A, please ask for gender neutral applications. So very often the bias creeps in from stage one when you ask, there is a vacancy and you call for applications and you ask people to give them what is the sex, what is the name, what is the, put a picture. I think there itself the bias starts to creep in, and the council that is looking at the applications starts to move in a certain direction, and then the rest of the things just flow as they've been doing for several years. So we need to make some paradigm shifts in the way applications are looked at, in the way positions are looked at, and women need to be much more vocal in demanding their rights, in demanding equal pay, and corporates have to fall in line, because like I said, we are the majority, and if you want a more productive business environment, equality comes into every aspect of the professional life, right?
Katja, is that something that you would echo also with your experience with a lot of programs?
Is it? Yeah, definitely. I would completely echo that. So the one is raising our own voice. The other is having support mechanisms, but changing structures. So I know a lot of funding organizations already implemented it. We are on the way to implement not to have pictures anymore, not to indicate the gender in applications anymore. So to have a complete neutral look on things. So I think the couple has to come from both sides. There's a lot of discussion in Germany for quotas at the moment, ongoing for boards, for serving. That is a bit tricky, I have to say. So I have a bit of a personal perspective there. Would I like to be in a position because I'm on the quota or because I have a good education and I do a good work? So there's a bit of difficulty in that question, I have to say. Would maybe Anandi and Sri, if you could comment on that, would be interested in your position on that. So quotas can be useful, but my personal perspective, I said I'm a bit biased there, but for sure we need to set up framework conditions and regulations. And I mean, the pay gap, you can also regulate, at least in public service, In STEM research organizations, we don't have the pay gap because it's regulated. So one could think here on policy frameworks and setting regulations.
Okay, interesting. I think we've hit on a hot topic here because Anandi immediately raised her finger. So I hand it over to you to react to what Katja said about quotas and other regulation. What's your take on that?
I think Sri also wanted to say, but I feel that in India, the board position, having a woman on a board position, has been mandatory for some time now. So you have to have at least one woman on board. And it is not always a diversity card. And it's at the end of the day what the woman makes out of it, right? So I think unless initially there is some sort of regulation to ensure that there is an entry point for women onto boards and decision-making powers, it will never happen. So I think it's a good start. But going forward, again, that position has to be filled by somebody who has merit. Sometimes, all things being equal, you still go for a man. So can we say that all time things being equal, for a while, can we go for a woman so that it is a little more balanced, the board is balanced, and then we can start looking going forward completely on a merit or something like that. So initially, you need a little bit of a support, a crutch, and then maybe things will neutralize. But I would love to hear from Sri what she thinks on this.
Please go ahead, Sri.
No, I won't be able to comment on the pay gap in general. I'm not the expert. But what I can tell what's working in PNG, personally, what I see is wherever there's an objective way of determining the pay. For example, in PNG, it's very, very, very clearly linked to performance. And within, for a particular level in the company, there's a pay range that can be given. And subject to the performance of the individual, whether it's male or female, they get that pay. That gives me a lot of confidence that my pay is determined by my performance. And there's guardrails within which managers and senior management can operate, which make sure I'm getting paid fairly versus my peers. Right? I personally have a lot of confidence in this kind of performance-based pay, which has guardrails and benchmarked versus the industry. And I think that's what all organizations should adopt. Otherwise, what ends up happening is if it's really the discretion of, let's say, the manager or a certain group of people, then of course we are all humans and we are biased. And bias creeps in and it can result in a pay gap. So that's my perspective on the pay gap.
Good. Interesting. A bit of a diverse picture here when it comes to also quotas and the pay gap. When it comes to regulation, it's interesting. There was just, I believe, a very, very short time ago, a court decision in Germany that obliges, or theory at least obliges, companies to pay equally qualified men and women the same amount. And I think it was precisely the case that I don't know all of the details, but that the company had argued in court that a particular man was paid more because he negotiated better than his female counterpart. And the court actually explicitly rejected that as an argument. So we'll have to see, of course, how that plays out in practice. But I think that also shows that some of these discussions are reaching the stage of the judiciary or the field of regulation. Now, we have about 6 or so minutes left in our format, and I would like to use those maybe to switch things around a little bit. We talked a lot about women catching up and how women could break into this male-dominated world, but we also saw that women, of course, have unique strengths also, and we heard from Sri that she believed that her role as a mother might qualify her better, actually, for her job than others. But there are also some unique characteristics, I believe, that are more dominant maybe in women than in men that may play a role here. And I just want to mention some is that, in general, and I think that also holds true for STEM, is that we see a shift away from manual labor. Yeah, so where, you really had to lift things and work with machines that were difficult to operate, to more importance of creativity, collaboration, and so on and so forth. And those are, traditionally qualifications that are said to be more dominant in women than in men. So could we also turn this around so that we say, you know, if we look into the future looks rather bright for women in the workforce? Who would like to? Anand, you're at least you're nodding, so it seems that you're you see that there might be a point, or is it too far fetched?
Difficult to say. I think we need to look, put a lot of systems in place, a lot of tools for women in place, which I am really glad to see that with this entire dialogue around women happening a lot these days at various fora, governments of the world, the UN, the G20. So I think there is a lot of messages that's going out into the world. So I think that will help us to amplify what is already being happening and probably put in. But whether these will immediately result in, you know, more women coming into the workforce, we really have to see. But again, if we can have a very conscious strategy of keeping women active and productive in the workforce between the ages of 30 to 45 through entrepreneurship, through home-based jobs, through you know, skilling while being inactive, I think it would help a long way to kind of get them back into the workforce as and when they are comfortable and they can do. And a couple of things that even Sri pointed out, I'm hearing more and more about companies allowing their women to bring children into the work area, and interestingly, even giving a nanny for them when they travel or in client-facing positions. This was recently reported to us from a company which said that we have initiated it, and they found a great response that at least 10% more women started to take on client-facing positions because they could travel with their child. So we have to think a little bit out of the box. A couple of areas where we really need to look a little bit more is, like, for example, a startup in Germany, a young girl told me she's working in a field which is about sustainable materials in manufacturing, in housing. And she said, when I go into a construction site, there are not even toilets for women. So I think, you know, there are so many issues that need to be picked up because they're not talked about, and we need to start plugging the holes in each of these areas, and over the next 10 to 15 years, we will see a change.
Great. Sri, Katja.
Maybe I can add that. I would completely second that. So one has to see what's happening. Maybe a bit from the German perspective, I think there is not an, if it's necessary. No, we are lacking workforce, we are decreasing society. We need that we get women in back into the workforce, and I think things will change by themselves. So I think that's a bit of a different situation to India. But I think we will see a change. There's a lot of discussion ongoing. And I think the discussions which we have today, but also in the public, not this G20 engagement group, which has been put up. But what I also see in Germany, but also in India, the discussions, the programs, the drive, so the policy is also driving it. So I think we will see a change, not just due to the changing world environment and manufacturing is less. I think that's a transition we had already in Germany. But I think in a specific case of the European countries having this huge lack of workforce and the necessity to keep well-trained women in the jobs and to contribute to society and to economic wealth. So I think this might be a bit the difference to India. It might be a bit specific to Europe or the Northern Hemisphere. But there's no doubt on that. The question is now a bit how and how to make it faster.
Yeah. Sri?
No, I'm an optimist. I tend to think the future is bright, and we are in a much better place than where we were before. So, I truly wish together conversations like these, and as more and more women become role models, occupy positions of influence, I truly think the future for my daughter is going to be much brighter.
Okay, good. By this, obviously, I think a good opportunity to close on a very positive note. And I believe that there were too many issues to really summarize them, or at least I wouldn't. But what I take away from this conversation is that there is no one silver bullet that solves it all. There are many things that we need to address. Some of them are big cultural changes, regulatory changes. Some of them are small, down to the question whether there is a toilet or not in a particular workplace. but they all have to be addressed. What I found very important, and this has come up several times in the conversation, is the role of, or the importance of, mentors and role models. And that makes me particularly happy, because I believe that our three panelists here, they are both exemplary role models in their own right, and are also involved in mentorship. And I think that's very encouraging. So we all have to work together. There's a lot of things to do, but we must do to include more women in the workforce. And by the way, if I may say that, it's not just a normative thing, because it's the right thing to do, and we should support women, but because I think it's fundamentally important also for us as society to progress. We need to harness the best talents, no matter what their background, where they come from, and what gender they are. So thank you very much to my three panelists here. I think this was a wonderful discussion. We could have continued. There is more to talk, but that's always better to have to end with more things to say than the other way around. So thank you very much for being part of this discussion. And let's hope that Sri's prediction is right, that the future for her female children will look better than for today's generation. I think that's an optimistic outlook. Thank you very much, and see you next month for another installment of the Indo-German Business Talk.
Thank you so much for having us. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.